Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, good evening. If we could please come to order. This is the July 16th, 2018 meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and all five commissioners are present. So we would ask Mr. Lashley, please, to give the invocation and lead us in the pledge.
Be glad to. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to honor you. We honor you in the way we live our lives, the way we treat other people, and we ask you to continue to bless our great nation. Give us freedom, give us energy, and the backbone to stand up for what's right. Help us be with the taxpayers tonight. Everything we say and do be a pleasing to you. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, public speakers. We have been in the habit of going over our public speaking policy in the past few months, but we've gone over it plenty, so I'm going to skip that tonight and go straight to the speakers. We have two signed up to speak. You'll have 3 minutes apiece, and the first is Emily Sutton. And if you would please state your name and spell your last name and give your address for the record, please.
Hello, my name is Emily Sutton. That last name is S-U-T-T-O-N, and I'm the Haw River Keeper. Thank you, Commissioners and Chairman Gailey, for the opportunity to speak tonight. My name is Emily Sutton. I'm the Haw River Keeper with Haw River Assembly. We represent over 1,000 members in the watershed. Oh, my address, sorry. 2602 Saxapahaw Bethlehem Church Road, Graham. I think it's the longest address in the county, but as you all know, Mountain Valley Pipeline, LLC, has proposed a frack gas pipeline through Alamance County. MVP Southgate would cut through headwater streams in the Haw watershed and bring unnecessary risk to the county. The process of crossing these headwater streams would include clearing and grading land along the buffers to allow access to the floodplain, then damming up the streams. In the rocky creek beds of the Piedmont, this process requires coating drills with volatile organic chemicals and laying explosives in the creek beds to lay the pipe 3 feet underground. These volatile chemicals do not break down in water and cannot be removed in drinking water treatment. Many are known carcinogens. In the tributaries of the Haw, this would affect nearly 1 million drinking water users downstream. The volume of water released when the dams are removed would devastate aquatic habitats, but also carry significant sediment loads of nutrients and heavy metals in the sediment. Alamance County has already spent a substantial amount of money mitigating eroded stream banks to remove segments of waterways off of EPA's impaired waterway list. Many streams this proposed route plans to cross are also impaired, and this pipeline could be a long-term cost for the county through mitigating nutrient management and stream buffers along the pipeline. My colleague Caroline Hansley and I will provide you all with a summary done by an independent company documenting the lack of need for additional pipelines in North Carolina. Without spending too much time on this report, you'll see that the current capacity for fracked gas exceeds the projected demand in the state for the next 10 years. If you're wondering why a company would invest billions of dollars in a pipeline that no one needs, the answer is probably that the companies could be guaranteed a hefty rate of 14% rate of return by FERC. MVP has a legacy of misleading community members and landowners by providing minimal compensation for land or using eminent domain to take the land if landowners refuse. For landowners with tax credits for forestry plans on their land, easements would make them ineligible for the tax benefit. The tax rates for their properties would significantly increase. There are also significant safety threats associated with having a pipeline close to homes or businesses, including exposure to toxic fumes, contaminated drinking water and well water, respiratory problems, and severe headaches. Proximity to pipelines significantly lower property values, as we have already seen in eastern North Carolina along the route of the ACP. In the past month, there have been at least 3 gas explosions in the U.S., 1 deadly. Those pipelines were in predominantly remote locations, but this pipeline routes through populated areas and near homes, including ACC. With this pipeline of this diameter and pressure, I'm almost done, 5 seconds, the evacuation radius is 2,051 feet. Data shows that pipelines built in 2010s are failing at a rate similar to the failure rate for pipelines constructed pre-1940. So this pipeline puts the communities in Alamance County at risk and would only benefit the wealthy out-of-state corporations profiting off the destruction of our county. We hope you all will consider signing a resolution to publicly stand against the pipeline. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Caroline Hansley.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Caroline Hansley, and I live at 116 Jones Avenue in Hillsborough, North Carolina. I'm here on behalf of the Sierra Club. Hold on 1 second. Sorry, I'm going to pass these out real quick.
Right here. Right here.
Thank you. As I said, good evening, commissioners. I'm Caroline Hansley, and I'm here on behalf of the Sierra Club, which has more than 90,000 members and supporters in North Carolina, more than 600 in Alamance County. I'm here to communicate our strong opposition to the proposed Mountain Valley Pipeline Southgate extension because of the risks to water quality and the high cost to ratepayers for a project that is unnecessary to meet energy demand, as my colleague Emily just shared with you. As you consider this project, I want to share with you some important information to keep in mind because it is far from a done deal with more than 20 federal, state, and local permits left to acquire. Number one, solar and wind are already cheaper than gas without subsidies. Wind and solar have been the true unsubsidized lowest cost source of energy, thank you, in North Carolina for nearly 2 years. This is despite gas prices being at historical lows during those 2 years. Number two, gas forces North Carolinians to pay out of state for energy. Solar and wind can be generated in state with local workers and manufacturing capacity, adding up to $12 billion in North Carolina's economy every year. Furthermore, this project contradicts the county vision for thoughtful growth and development. But local power builds jobs and economic growth in North Carolina. Alamance County alone has gained more than $80 million in investment over the last 5 years from local power sources like solar and wind. Number three, local energy costs less than gas and it puts more people to work. For example, solar brings twice as many long-term full-time jobs and nearly 10 times as many construction jobs as the same amount of gas generation. I'm going to have to cut some. The 3 minutes is not enough to name all the problems in this proposed pipeline, but what I do want to say is that as of today, residents along the main line in West Virginia and Virginia have already found more than 150 water quality violations, and it's not even under full construction yet. As we move forward, I would urge you to consider the Mountain Valley Pipeline as an economic hazard, an ineffective and outdated energy source with negative economic impacts. Local energy lets the region look forward to growth, energy independence, thriving businesses, and abundant, accessible, permanent jobs. I ask you to support landowners in their opposition to the proposed Mountain Valley Pipeline and pass a resolution against this dirty, dangerous fossil fuel, and instead move the county toward 100% local renewable energy. I look forward to working with you on this resolution. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you so much. For the public's notice, we're discussing, the county manager and I have been discussing putting the Mountain Valley Pipeline on the agenda for August the 6th. And so that would be an opportunity for the company that promotes the pipeline to be here. And one representative from the groups that are opposed to the pipeline would be able to speak in the course of the regular meeting. Of course, we would have during the public comment period at the beginning of the meeting, 3 people opposed to the pipeline, 3 people in favor of the pipeline would have the opportunity to speak just as a matter of common practice. And then we'd have one person from the company and then one person representing those who object to the pipeline. And we're discussing a time limit possibly for presentations and that will be communicated before that meeting in an appropriate time so that parties can plan, so that we don't have 2 one-hour presentations for and against the pipeline. So that is, I wanted to deliver that information. Is there any other responses from the commissioners?
I'd like to say a couple of things. I appreciate the two speakers coming to speak to us. I really have to say that I am in agreement with their comments. Jeremy, one of the misleading points of information that MVP was putting out there was that it was going to generate, this pipeline would generate something like, was it $1.2 or $1.3 million worth of tax revenue per year? I mean, that's equal to a penny of our property tax rate. And I asked Jeremy, what does the current Colonial Pipeline generate in tax revenue? Now, they may not be the same, but it...
Just a tiny fraction.
It was like $17,000 or something. I mean, I just can't imagine that it could be that much of a delta. And I really haven't heard any groundswell of need from anybody in the public. It's just the private companies that are saying, yeah, there's a big need for this. And it's affecting, I see, I can't remember your name, or Mr.
Daniel Bollinger.
Bollinger, thank you. It was one of the property owners who would be affected, and there's a video done about his story that is really quite impressive and how it impacts individual property owners for something where there's really not a public need for. So I just think we need to, I'm glad that it's going to be on the agenda, that we can consider a resolution. And so we'll see. Maybe there'll be some points from the other side that we'll hear next time. But
I had a question that I think Emily brought up. I'm going to ask Jeremy. Is that true? If that severs their property and they have in conservation easement, it's going to affect them?
So you know, what I'm thinking about is the folks that are currently in present use are getting some mm-hmm. sort of deferral. If they can't manage it for agriculture, horticulture, or timber, it would have to come out. Now, the reality is that we wouldn't restore it to the normal market rates because it's encumbered by the easement. We put some sort of a waste or residual, so it wouldn't inflate all the way up, but it would be an increase.
It would mess up what they've been doing and following our rules all along. So, yeah.
I meant to say one other thing, if I could, that the matter of promoting solar and wind power, sustainable power, is so important, I believe. Natural gas is a fossil fuel, and yes, cleaner than coal, and produces less carbon dioxide, but the methane that may be produced in its manufacture may offset that, I'm not sure. I live by what I believe, and I believe in solar energy. We have solar panels on our house. My wife and I drive electric vehicles, and I just really think that that's the direction we ought to go in as a society.
All right. If there are no other responses from the commissioners, next would be approval of the agenda. If everyone has had opportunity to review the agenda,
I'll make a motion. Or second that then.
I have a motion and a second for approval of the agenda. Is there any other discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next, we have the consent agenda. If everybody has had a chance to review the consent agenda, do you have any questions?
I move approval.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second for approval of the consent agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, next we have something really fun to do, and that is to recognize Brenda Blunt for her service for quite a number of years. She must have started when she was 15 on the Alamance County Board of Elections. So I just have some things to share about Brenda's service. It's with great appreciation that we recognize Brenda W. Blunt for her commitment to the citizens of Alamance County through 19 years of dedicated service as a member of the Alamance County Board of Elections. Brenda Blunt was appointed to the Board of Elections in 1999 to fill the position vacated by longtime board member Gilberta Mitchell, who had served since 1977. Brenda served from her appointment in 1999 through March 29, 2018. When appointed to the board in 1999, Brenda was employed by the Alamance County District Attorney's Office, from which she retired in 2000. Following retirement, she devoted her time to the Board of Elections and community projects. Although nominations of the members of the county boards of elections are made through the political parties, Brenda served all of the citizens of Alamance County by assuring fair and impartial elections and remaining neutral in her decisions and judgment. Brenda served most of her 19 years as secretary of the Board of Elections. Brenda is married to Orlando Blount, and they have two adult children. So, you have something to present her with, and this is Kathy Holland, our supervisor of elections.
Director of elections.
Director of elections, sorry.
I present this to you on behalf of the past members and the current members of the Board of Elections, myself, and the citizens of Alamance County, and we thank you for your service.
I want to say a little something. We are looking at the best director in the state of North Carolina.
That's right.
She is absolutely wonderful. She's a hard worker, and she cares about the Board of Elections. She does an awful lot that she does not get paid for. She deserves a lot more. Her staff deserves a lot more. They are the hardest working people in show business. and really and truly, you would not believe the hours that they spend at the Board of Elections. During election time, they have no life, and some people think that's how it's supposed to be. Well, it's not. Most boards don't work like this. And some of the county wants them to do more. I say, unless you give her more staff and more money, don't allow them to put any more on her. Her hands are doubly full. And I love you, Kathy. I've enjoyed being with you. And you take care.
Thank you. That's just why we love her, Brenda, so much, is she has the opportunity to take the stage and she passes it off to somebody else and recognizes other people. She uses her time to bring glory to others, and that's just her all over the place. So thank you. All right, Cindy Colley is talking to us about performance contracting for ACC tonight, and we have a resolution to approve, I think.
Good evening, commissioners. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present this to you tonight. Of course, I'm here on behalf of the college, and I have here with me a couple of folks. Tom Hartman, who's our Director of Administrative and Fiscal Services, Kevin Overcash from Piedmont Service Group, and Kat Stahl, who's from the North Carolina Utility Savings Initiative. So I have a good team with me in case there's detailed questions. Of course, you had an update in the package of where the college is at with our performance contracting and also a copy of the resolution, but I just wanted to hit a couple of the highlights of how far we've come and where we're headed and what we need at this point. As we've discussed before at county commissioner meetings, the college is in need of some major HVAC repairs and replacements, and what we opted to do was to begin the performance contracting process a little over a year ago to start researching, see if this was something that the college could enter into and would be beneficial. And of course, essentially what performance contracting is that we would finance the replacements and repairs to our HVAC system through energy savings. That's how we would make our debt payments. So also note that performance contracting is, of course, regulated under the North Carolina Utility Savings Initiative, which is part of the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality. So there's very prescribed and detailed steps that we have to follow, and of course the college has followed those. One of our first steps was to complete an initial assessment, which we did, which we started actually last summer, and it showed that this was a viable option for us, that we could finance an HVAC project between the dollar amount between $2.2 million and $3.4 million. So that gave us kind of the go-ahead to do further research and also to advertise for an energy service company, or commonly called an ESCO, that would lead us through this process. And at the May Board of Trustees meeting of the college, we did approve energy service company, Piedmont Service Group. So where we're at now is we need to perform a detailed investment grade audit to thoroughly research what we can do and come up with our financing plan. And before we go to that step, we have to come before the county commissioners and ask not to reduce appropriations, even though we'll have energy savings, because those savings is what we will use to pay the financing on the project. So that's where we're at. Where we're at, we have a resolution, and I can answer any questions if you have.
I have a question. So this works because you borrow the money, and then you have to make payments on that money mm-hmm. to replace and repair the equipment to produce energy savings.
Right.
And then the money that you save is used to pay the debt service on the loan that you would take.
Yes.
But that only works if we continue a level amount of funding for utilities.
Correct.
And now, correct. So the question is, do we... When we do support your budget each year, is it that specific on a line item basis?
We don't break it out.
But I guess we would have to if this went
yes.
through.
And what we, our current utility costs are a little over $630,000. And
technically, I mean, legislatively, that's our responsibility. Is that not right?
Just correct, like the way I understand
with the schools,
it.
We mm-hmm. were responsible for facilities and the maintenance of those facilities.
Yeah, correct.
And the utilities of that.
Yes. Okay.
Yes. So that's the way it would work. But in our budget request each year, we can start breaking that down for you, what the finance payments are and how we're using that money instead of paying utilities or paying financing.
Well, another curious question is the ESCO that you've chosen mm-hmm. is it, was that the same one that the ABSS chose when they were evaluating that?
I don't think so. I think Brady was one.
Oh, that's right, it was Brady
working with them.
Mm-hmm. That doesn't matter. I mean, I'm sure you did your due diligence and picked
oh, yes,
the most
yes it's quite a tedious process. Yeah. Of course, RFP process, reviewed, presented to our Buildings and Grounds Committee, and then to our board.
And one thing I learned in the working with ABSS on their project was that this is very much regulated mm-hmm. by one of the state agencies. Mm-hmm. Is it, I can't think of the name of the regulatory entity in Raleigh.
What's the North Carolina Utility Savings Initiative, which is under the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality.
Okay.
I think I'm saying that right. Yes. Mm-hmm. So. Heavily regulated, prescribed
so
steps.
Does not the local government commission have a role in this?
Yes, they will, yeah. once we yeah. go out for the financing.
Right. How long is the loan for?
15 years.
15 years.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I mean, it makes sense, to the extent that otherwise this would be a capital expenditure for us to do this.
Right.
So it's an alternate way of financing this important need.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
There was a resolution included in the agenda packet. Should I read that, or can we just have a motion to approve the resolution as presented?
Just a motion would be sufficient.
Okay, yeah. Everybody's got it in the packet.
Well, I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Great. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, we have a request to set a public hearing regarding the Alamance County Watershed Protection Ordinance. Sherry Hook.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Hey, how you doing?
All right.
I am not the planning director. So, but I'm going to make this work.
We thought we were going to give you a new title.
You thought, yeah. So I'm before you tonight because sometime last year, the Division of Water Resources conducted an audit looking at our Jordan Lake rules and our buffer protection program. There are several issues that we have already addressed with them, provided them with some information. There's three recommendations that they have come back to us with. We've talked about this numerous times. Libby's been in front of you guys to talk about this. But I'm going to just go through the three recommendations and then ask that we set a public hearing. So the first recommendation was to update the watershed protection ordinance. We need to amend the ordinance so that single-family homes, which include subdivisions, are not exempted from the watershed protection. So this is going to require adding a letter F to section 102 and then also updating section 204 of the ordinance. That's going to give us, the section 204 will give us reference to the most recent rules in the stream and buffer protection. So the other, so that's the first thing. The next recommendation is regarding our maps. We're working with GIS. We're getting that taken care of. We are also working on approval of an alternative map for implementation. So that's kind of still in the works. And then the last response regarded annual reporting. They asked us to report annually, but they did not give us a form or a method to do that reporting. So they are working to develop an annual submission process. And once that's completed, we will start making that submission. So the thing that we need to do right now is to take this information back to the planning board, which they've already seen these suggested changes in the watershed ordinance. We'll take that back to them on August 9th, and we're just asking that we set a public hearing for August 20th regarding those changes.
It's my understanding we really didn't have a choice in this.
We really didn't, no.
I'll be happy to make the motion. I do have a couple of questions.
Okay.
The part about private homeowners and subdivisions not being exempt, mm-hmm. How do you think our private homeowners along the watershed are going to react to this? Is it going to be burdensome to them to comply
for future with construction?
Just for future construction.
Yeah, yes, it'd be for future construction, not for right now. Mm-hmm.
And then I was surprised that when I read this, it looks like they don't accept the GIS mapping at this point.
Right.
And I thought, I'm just surprised at that. Mm-hmm. I would think that our state would be further along than that.
And that's the piece that we're still working
on. So we can be proud that our county is further along than the state.
Right.
It's one way of looking at it. I'll second that motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? The motion is, I believe, to correct me if I'm wrong, the motion is to set a public hearing for Monday, August 20th at 7 p.m. to receive public comments on proposed changes to the Alamance County Watershed Protection Ordinance. Was that your motion?
Yes. That's my motion. Thank you.
Yes.
Well said.
Motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have a Board of Health appointment. Ms. Saunders.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So we have an appointment to the Board of Health that we would like for you to consider. In the past, you all have asked for a recommendation from the board, particularly if we have more than one applicant, and we do have that in this case. And so the Board of Health met on June 19th and reviewed four applicants for the Board of Health general public representative vacancy that we currently have. Just to give you a little background, when we have multiple applications, even when we have one application, I typically will meet with the person in person or by the phone to give them an overview of the health department, an overview of the functions of the Board of Health, the time commitments required for it, and a summary of the application to appointment process, just so that they're completely in the know. And so the Board of Health reviewed all four applicants and made a recommendation of Mrs. Rodriguez-Rassi. And Mr. Bird serves on our Board of Health. Would you like to provide any additional input as to the recommendation?
Sure. So we had four applicants, and there's really quite a bit of discussion around all of them with the board. And we landed on this candidate because she's just really well-connected in the community, and she brings the diversity that we need representing the Latino community. She's works for ACC, and we thought that would be a good connection as well. So we really felt like her qualifications stood above the qualifications of the rest for this particular at this particular time. So that's why we came up with recommending her.
Thank you.
I wanted to address, commonly appointments to boards are handled under the consent agenda, and Mr. Haygood and I talked about putting this under the consent agenda and just doing it as with the Board of Health's recommendation. But since there were four applicants, I thought that we would just go ahead and bring it before the board so that if anybody had a question or wanted to advocate for another candidate that they knew personally, that they would have the opportunity.
Sounds good. I would make a motion that we accept your recommendation.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second that we appoint Eleanor Rodriguez Rossi to the Public Health Board. Is there any further discussion?
Is that Attorney Rossi's wife?
Ever Rossi?
Yeah.
His name is Aura.
I don't know.
Different.
Spelled differently, anyhow.
I don't know.
Well, his name is R-O-S-S-I.
And hers is the R-A-S-S-I.
Who were the other three, may I ask? I apologize.
Sure. The other three were Marie Elena Castroneta, Melissa Enoch DeBerry, and Sean Jackson.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
No.
Thank you.
Next, the library. MJ Wilkerson.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We submitted our LSTA Library Services and Technology Act grant last November and received word January 7th that we were awarded the $100,000 project grant to be used towards the purchase of a bookmobile. And so I'm seeking your approval to accept our grant.
So moved.
That's easy.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve receiving the grant of $100,000. Is there any further discussion?
It's exciting.
If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
And MJ, this bookmobile, this is not just a van.
No, it is actually a mobile library branch.
It's like a huge...
It's about the size of a Greyhound bus,
yeah.
And it's pretty much full library services. You can check out books. You can do computer research. We will teach classes on it. All the just modified, but all the services that you still do in a regular library, you're going to be able to do from this branch. We'll carry programs. It really is a mobile library, and we've already established four stops in the northern end of the county, the Scott Health Clinic, Altamaha. There's a church across from the Altamaha Ossipee.
Fairview.
Right, Fairview Church, Pleasant Grove, and what's the fourth one? Best Schmidt Park in the northern end, and we're working. We've got three established in the southern end: Cedar Rock, the Friends, Cane Creek Friends, and we're trying to get in touch with Mount Zion Church because that's way, way over near Kimesville, and we're trying to get
the location all day long.
No, we will be at those locations in the hours after school.
Okay.
So in the summer, we will be there from 3 to 7. one day a week, you know, one day at each of those stops. And then in the winter, it will be from 2 to 6, because we felt very strongly that we wanted the school children to have access to these resources.
Yeah.
Because, of course, as you all know and are tired of hearing me preach about, we feel very strongly about the importance of our role in education.
What kind of internet reception will you offer?
We will have, it will be set up as our mobile cafe. Right. Well, we will be set up just like our mobile cafe is, with hotspots attached to the bookmobile, and it will broadcast out, and people will have access to it there. And we've already, poor old Jason drove around all over the county and looked at the access on his cell phone to be sure that there was access there. So we're very excited about it. And during the mornings, when it's not actually at those scheduled stops, it will be going to senior centers and retirement places, and so it will be available for other populations as well.
Well, I really look forward to seeing it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We're excited.
A lot of thought's been put behind this and scheduling and all.
We have really thought long and hard about it, and everybody, the question I keep getting is, it seems like an antiquated idea, but it's interesting, more and more libraries are implementing this kind of service, and so many parts of our area are rural, and our three main branches are right in the middle of our county, and as you know, north and south, it's a very rural area. So
very good.
Thank you
so much. Mr.
Aikens. Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening. How you doing?
Doing well.
Thank you.
All right. So, unlike our real property, where the county has the burden of listing and appraising property, when it comes to personal property, we rely on self-reporting. So business owners, once a year, give us a listing of what property they hold and what they paid for it, and from that we generate a bill. Now, what you might imagine is, when you're talking about self-reporting, well, how do you ensure that you're getting an accurate reporting? And the answer is auditing program. If the business knows that you're watching and that you're going to pull a certain amount every year and you're going to check those counts and verify, then there's incentive for the business to be accurate. In fact, we find that about 70% of audits come back completely clean, no problems. About 30%, there are problems, but predominantly they're just accidents or misunderstandings. Very few businesses intentionally mislist. And certainly they know that auditing program is there. So we don't have the capacity in-house to run an auditing program for over 4,000 businesses. Instead, we've always outsourced. Right now we're outsourced to a company called Tax Management Associates. We've been with them on a 5-year contract, and there was a previous contract with them before that time. When this 5-year contract expired, I had to ask myself, are we getting the best value for our citizens? And I worked with Randy Clark to develop a bid process to put it out there and see what does the market offer today. The results, what we had four major firms in the state reply back. We compared, they all had excellent credentials. We checked out references, we looked at the qualifications of their auditors. To my mind, they're very comparable. There are different strengths and weaknesses, but I can't say that one is particularly better or worse. So it will give us more quality or less quality. But what I can say is who will give us the lowest price. And Evans & Associates, when they bid the work, came in $70 below what we have currently. It's 10% less than we're paying right now per audit. And so my recommendation would be that we enter into contract with Evans as the low bidder to provide this outsourced auditing service going forward. Now, we've already budgeted $100,000 per year for this purpose, and I would like to ask the board to approve that we can go forward with that agreement.
Do we usually recapture enough tax revenue to offset the cost of the audit?
Yes. Now, historically, we always have, in fact, had a positive revenue flow, recapturing more than the cost of the audit. The past 5 years have not been that generous. We are looking at probably being very close to break even when all the numbers are in, which is challenging. I get the distinct impression that the county's been overworked just a little bit. There's a certain amount of volume that you can handle and volume you can't handle, and we're very close to that edge. Our current budget has shown a reduction in auditing just because I think we're very close to that threshold.
That's where we need to be, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You know where we want to be?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to enter into this agreement for business personal property auditing services. I have one quick question.
Sure.
With farmers, I know that y'all, our internal people audit farms to be sure that they're still in the present use, but farmers also have equipment that they use
Absolutely.
In farming. Is this group who goes out and audits the first, like the tractors and and the business equipment that a farm uses?
Yes, they do that as well.
Okay, that's my question. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you so much. Okay, Mr. Haygood.
Well, good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
The board will remember back on June 18th at the commissioners meeting. At that time, the board approved signing a new memorandum of understanding with the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services pertaining to our relationship with the Department of Social Services. This was an agreement that we were required to sign by law. We didn't have any choice but to sign. And it detailed the expectations of the Department of Health and Human Services and the responsibilities of Alamance County. The commissioners indicated that they would sign the new agreement, but they had concerns and they wanted an opportunity to express those concerns. So Mr. Albright and Ms. Osborne worked together and have put together the resolution that's in your package this evening. Just a few high points from this resolution. It does state the commissioners' concerns that there could be unrealistic performance standards in the new agreement with the state, that the MOU is not tailored just for Alamance County. It's standard for all 100 counties, and that gives us some pause. Also, that we could find ourselves in a position where slight statistical deviations would have great impacts, making it very hard for DSS to achieve the benchmarks the state has set. The resolution also points out that there isn't any mechanism given for an impartial mediator in case we get into a dispute with the state. And it also requires that we use NCFAS to measure results, which I believe the Department of Social Services have some concerns. That's been a good program idea, but very difficult to roll out. But bottom line, appreciate the work that Mr. Albright and Ms. Osborne did putting this together. I think it does a good job of capturing possible concerns and things that could happen that the board should be concerned about. If you review it and approve it, we would send it to the state along with the signed copy of the agreement between the county and the Department of Health and Human Services. So at this point, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them, but I think it does a pretty good job of summarizing concerns.
So I'm not opposed to it necessarily, but I will say that at the last board meeting of the Association of County Commissioners that I attended, I think it was like June 29th or June 30th up in Asheville, Secretary Cohen came and spoke to the group, and she talked about this and was a little bit put off by all the counties doing things like this. Several apparently are. And points out that this is not the department's doing. This is the doing of the North Carolina legislature. And I didn't read until I read this, and Clyde, I'm sure you have it right, that the legislation allows for the department to either do a standardized agreement or to do individual ones. And I think Secretary Cohen's was kind of saying they really don't have the staff. They don't have, you know, it's kind of like an unfunded mandate to do it separately, you know, different for all 100 counties, and that would be quite a task, as you can imagine. But it seems like, tell me if I'm wrong, but it's amusing to me, we go through all these whereas clauses saying all these things we don't like about the relationship, but what we're resolving has nothing to do with all those whereas clauses. We're just resolving that the two people who can sign it are you and our DSS director.
But they're limiting the authority. We're recognizing the fact that the state is an 800-pound gorilla, and we don't have any choice. That's why we use the Latin
contra.
Well, I didn't.
Yeah, we didn't know all about that.
So what does that mean?
That means that if we get into a tight spot.
Yeah.
We've said that, we didn't have any bargaining authority. And that means that the person that drafted the contract is construed against that being the state.
So what does that have to do with who signs the contract?
It's a legal term of art, authorizing it to sign under that condition. Because my fellow county attorneys across the state had a 3 or 4 page addendum which did nothing more than aggravate the state, and they kicked it back. So we took the approach, we just put it in a resolution, recognizing the authority of the person that's going to sign it based upon the fact that it is a one-sided, one person drafted it and is saying sign it or else.
So basically it was a non-bargained agreement.
That's right.
Well, that's right.
Yes,
it is. Yeah.
And you're correct.
Latin term.
Yeah,
there are a number of counties. I think we've seen multiple counties that have put together similar documents and sent them in with their signed agreement with the state. But it is an opportunity to say these are our concerns because we're just not sure what this is going to mean for the future.
I just think it's important that we try to not lose sight of the objectives statewide about doing this, because I mean the objectives is to do what's best for our kids.
Sure.
And make sure that all the counties are putting forth the effort necessary to achieve those metrics. So.
But it's really expensive and complicated and difficult to treat all the counties the same. I mean,
they're not the same.
Yeah, because we're not the same. And if the if our Department of Social Services is doing a great job, why subject them to a layer of oversight that's not necessary because another county, another part of the state's not holding up their end.
Mm-hmm. Well, I agree with what you say. I mean, I understand that all the whereas clauses in here and the necessity for them, but Secretary Cohen admits that this is going to be a work in progress. And, you know, this is new. I can't remember the legislator's name from Wake County, I think, that was behind this legislation.
Not Behringer.
Behringer, thank you. And so, I mean, that's where it started.
Well, I would think that Secretary Cohen would welcome the counties, you know, promoting a different perspective than maybe what the General Assembly was seeing, and the more discussion about it, if it is burdensome on them and they weren't really behind it to start with, that the counties uniting in promoting their interests would help DHHS in presenting a different point of view to the General Assembly.
Well, this could accomplish that.
And I think it's great. I think that when the counties work together and unite in our common interests to face the powers that be in Raleigh, I think that's
exactly what we have to do.
And good. All right. Do we have a motion?
I'll make the motion. We accept.
I'll second Bill's motion.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Or yes.
Anyone opposed? Now we're going to talk about our strategic plan.
Thank you, Chair Gailey. And there's been a tremendous amount of work put into the strategic plan. It's been a very long process. I think it actually started in 2014 and has been walked through by planning department, county manager's department, lots of different folks have worked. At this time, I'd like to ask Andrew Rollins, project analyst with county manager's office, to come up. She's going to take you through a PowerPoint presentation about the strategic plan. You all should have a copy of it in your packet. This is the document, the meat that's behind. We've had a mission and a vision statement and core values for quite some time. And this is the product of a lot of work. Andrea and Michelle have been key in it. So no further ado, turn it over to Andrew.
Let me just clarify one thing. This is for information tonight and not for a vote. Is that correct?
That's correct. Tonight, there's no vote required. We thought the best process for this would be to give it to the Board of Commissioners and the public, let you digest it, let the public have an opportunity to contact you about it if they have questions or concerns, and then the plan would be at the August 6th meeting to ask you to adopt it as our strategic plan for the next 5 years. Thank you.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
So this document is a draft. We'd like for it to be adopted in a form that meets your approval. In addition to talking a little bit about this document, I'd also like to talk a little bit about strategic planning in Alamance County, because there are a lot of things that are going on in Alamance County that are part of a bigger strategic plan initiative that we don't call it that normally. We don't publish anything that tells you that we're doing it. But this is the process. This visual that is on the screen starts at the top, talking about communication, walking through strategic plan activities. I pushed it to show communication at the top because really, strategic planning is all about answering the question, and I wrote it down so that I got it right. Are we meeting the needs of our residents, and are we using our public dollars and resources efficiently to do it? When you're talking, starting with communication, you're trying to be transparent. We're trying to gather information about trends in order to figure out that we're meeting the right needs. We're looking for feedback at all times, and then responding to it is part of what strategic planning, where we really start. The key elements of strategic planning, we've seen it before, vision, what do we want to be like for future generations? This is our vision statement, it's in the document, it's on our website. Mission statement, what is our purpose for existence? This is our mission statement. Also values, our core values, what are our beliefs and attitudes that guide our behavior and our relationship with others? All of this has been established as part of our five pillars. The next steps in strategic planning include the strategies and talking about performance, actually setting our priorities, allocating our resources, implementing our strategies, and then evaluating to see if we're successful. So in the packet, there's a 12-page document that's called Vision Alamance. It was intended to be short, easy to read. It's for the public consumption. It's going to list our five pillars and give further information. You should see in there the strategic planning vision mission statement, and on there's two pages assigned to each pillar. They're in no particular order. One is not prioritized any differently than another, but the two-page description is intended to give some background and a narrative section about what the discussions, the stakeholder discussions about that particular pillar. And then on the second page, there are performance metrics and some sample initiatives. By keeping it short, we didn't list a comprehensive list of all the initiatives that could be done for each of the pillar, but we tried to give some of the topics that came from stakeholder discussions, things that our department has felt were either already ongoing or were important. And the other thing that I wanted to mention is that while we've been working on producing this document, we've also been doing some of these initiatives through our performance management program. So the Vision Alamance document has the five pillars in it. I'd like to highlight just a couple of points for each of the pillars. The very first two pages on the preserving agriculture pillar are going to talk about initiatives that will promote awareness for preserving agriculture with education programming, and also for supporting our local farmers, our present use tax program that you mentioned earlier, and also an initiative for finding funding to actually preserve farmland. I'm not sure that it was published, it's not been announced, that we can congratulate Brad Moore and our VAD on receiving a grant recently. The North Carolina Agricultural Development and Farmland Preservation Trust Fund has given some funds for preserving a dairy farm as well as some cropland in Alamance County. So congratulations.
That's right, that's brand new. And
fresh
so, yes, we have two farms that have been accepted into the state's farmland preservation program. And as I understand it, a key factor in Alamance County's having two farms chosen this year is the fact that we have our local matching dollars, the $100,000 that we have in our county budget to go toward that program. And I think that's really awesome. I'm glad you mentioned that, because
It's a great chance to highlight the work of the Voluntary Agriculture District Board, which implements that program. And I sit on that, I don't vote, but I attend those meetings, so really excited about that.
And I do too, and I think that's wonderful. Can I just make a comment about that? So in the initiatives section of this pillar, you mentioned that farmland preservation program, certification to qualify farmland as an Alamance County Voluntary Agriculture District. Well, I think we need to include verbiage in that same point to include this farm preservation fund that, you know, does the, I don't know how you should word it, but what you just described with the two farms that got this money, because that's permanent easements on those farm properties that'll prevent them from being used for anything else but farming in perpetuity. So, I mean, that's more than the Voluntary Agriculture District, if I understand the program right. And in fact, I think that might be even more important than the Voluntary Ag District. I just think that some wording to that effect ought to be included in the.
You have to be section. In the Voluntary Ag District to be qualify for the program. It's like a three-tiered thing. Okay. You have to be in the Voluntary Agriculture District, and then you have to qualify for the present use value taxation, right. Which actually I think it's the other way around. You have to qualify for the present use taxation, and then you get into the Voluntary Ag District, and then you can qualify for the farmland preservation program.
But I just think that's an important part of the initiative to note that.
Yes, we'll update some language there for your review. Moving on, we have smart growth and development as a pillar as well. I've covered my notes, hang on. So there's three areas in smart growth that are categories for initiatives. One is preserving our open spaces and natural resources. That's covered tremendously well by our parks plan. There's a lot of good information in the comprehensive parks plan. Another initiative area is to promote smart development and to collaborate with our community for community development. So we have a couple of different layers there if we're involved in economic development at all. As our community grows and there is community development going on, what is our role there? The initiatives that we should be looking at from the county viewpoint, as well as the expansions and the pressures on our school system. So all of that would be involved under the smart growth and development. There are initiatives in place there.
Can I make a suggestion on this one too?
Yes, please.
So it's a balance between economic growth and preservation of natural resources, which is important. But on the economic side, I'm wondering if it wouldn't be smart to put an indicator on there. The impact, you know, we spent a lot of time discussing new opportunities to attract new businesses. And out in the community, everybody's concerned that we don't have enough good paying jobs. And so the companies that we bring in, I think, do help raise the average level, raise the prosperity of the community, not just in tax revenues, but in higher paying jobs than what we currently have on average. And I think an indicator that we ought to be measuring would be that. How are we can do it either just measuring the impact of the new jobs or the impact on the overall average incomes of a community. I mean, one or the other would be fine with me, but just I think it just ought to be mentioned as something to measure.
All right. I've added a note. We'll look at the impact on wages and give you something to review. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Before you go on from this pillar, maybe, Mr. Hager, could you update us on what's going on with the planning department very quickly?
Yes, we've posted the position we have for planning director. It's been posted. It's actually closed. We've received multiple applications in. We've started our interview process, so we hope to have somebody hired within the next 30 days. We're probably looking at 30 to 60 days to get someone in and on board, but we're very excited to get someone in. We're currently contracting with a private company to do our planning services for us. Sherry has been working with that company on a regular basis. They come in, I believe, 2 days a week, man the office, meet with anybody that needs plans reviewed or signatures done. We also have Teresa is in place over there right now, serving as the administrative contact for the offices. She's done a very good job. So, I think things are functioning in planning. We'll be happy to get somebody on board as a director, but business is moving along. So.
Thank you.
Next pillar is world-class education. So a major intent there was partnering with the community, maintaining strong relationship with the ABSS, the community college, providing support programs through our libraries, our health department, parks, cooperative extension. You'll see that many of our departments have PM goals that support community education. So that's something that's, it's an underlying layer to everything that our government programs are doing. The initiatives in here are going to be related to the public school growth plan. I'm sorry, I'm still on economic development. The initiatives in here are really going to be in support of the strategic and operational activities that are going on with the school system in formal education. And then you'll see a lot of the activities that our departments have will be in support of community initiatives for education.
So I had just a couple of things on this.
Please.
Under county educational programs, I think we have a couple of other important departments that maybe ought to be included. DSS, for example, through the opportunities that might be provided through the Child Protective Services and the foster care functions to have a positive impact on our kids, on the education of our kids. And like in the Sheriff's Department, I mean, we've got school resource officers there that there's an opportunity with how they interact with the kids that further their education. And you know, we have this community initiative that's working on cradle to grave that the county needs to be at the table, and we are at the table. I mean, I'm the commissioner appointed representative on their steering committee, and our county manager or assistant county manager attends those meetings. And I think it's important that we denote that this is a major partner, community-wide partnership. And I love this. You have a theme of partnering in the community throughout this document, which I think is just great, because it's not just about government. It's about government working with community resources to achieve objectives. I just thought maybe a mention of Alamance and Cheeves. And then in the things that we measure, the indicators, you know, the school system put a lot of work into developing specific strategies. They have six strategies, and I kind of think that we ought to be looking at how well the system is doing on implementing those strategies as indicators, and maybe other, you know, Amy, you talked about what do we call them, the outcome measures, graduation rates and teacher turnover rates and things like that. Those we ought to be concerned with monitoring those as well.
Benchmarks,
thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree with that, and that under the initiatives we have established financial goals for targets for long-term support. I would like to see there be a linkage there back to the indicator that said the correlation between spending and student success. Because I don't think necessarily because you have a financial goal for long-term support that there's necessarily a linkage back to achievement.
I
would like to see that spelled out in there. I would respond to Mr. Bird's initial comment about the examples in the county educational programs, that those are examples to be included. Those three things there. I don't think that's intended to be exhaustive.
No, I agree with that. Yeah, I thought they were, they rose to the level to be worthy of mention in my mind. But.
Okay. So public health and safety is really where we see the majority of our departments are going to fall in there with a lot of different initiatives. We have three major categories where we're talking about providing a safe environment. Clearly the Sheriff's Department, our social services, health department, many of our departments are involved in providing a safe environment. Promoting a healthy lifestyle. That's another area where you can list a lot of different initiatives. And then responding with proactive and effective assistance to disasters and emergencies. That's a predominantly county function. There are other initiatives that are new, tactical, they are important, that can fall under these big headers, categories, and we have listed just a very few. Do you have any questions? So the last pillar that's listed is government accountability and resource management. Focusing effective resource management of our finances, our human resources, our facilities, our technology, and equipment. Accountability really is talking about better communication about county government and community and employee engagement. Those are the big categories under government accountability. Very basic initiatives. They're basic, they're easy to describe, but they are multifaceted. Are things related to employee engagement, recruitment, retaining, training our employees, engaging, feedback loops. All of that is various initiatives within that are all helping us build employee ambassadors. Our employees are our best feedback loop for how we're doing with the community. They receive one-on-one FaceTime when they're doing service delivery. And so it works both ways. They should have a way to be an ambassador for the county and to share back what they have learned from the public.
I like what you included on that one. I thought it was good.
I have one question about that part. When I read this, I thought about the IT department and their work with the security, internet security and cybersecurity for the county, and I know that Bruce has poured so much energy into that. I was wondering if maybe that was worthy of highlighting in here somehow. And that is, you know, our internet and our systems management is definitely our systems are definitely a resource, right? And how the IT department works to safeguard those things.
Okay, I'll make a note of that.
Yeah,
as well.
I would agree with that.
So really this document, it's short, it's sweet, it's meant to be overarching for whatever we as a community see as our changing needs within the next, we gave it a 5-year timeline, but the initiatives should fit within that framework is our hope. And then each year we have to look at what are our resources, what's available for these priorities. So when you look at this loop, strategic planning and setting priorities is still only part of this process. Allocating resources is that annual budget piece. The operational, what piece of it can we tackle this particular year? We did a slide just to give you kind of a snapshot for fiscal year 18-19, next year's budget. We set the departments as a whole into one of the pillars. So that's our entire $152 million budget is split up into this this pie chart. Public health and safety is the largest, 44.52%. World-class education comes in at 39.10. This is more than just the school system. There's funding there for AVS, SACC operations, capital planning, as well as our library. Government accountability and resource management at 11% is the next largest. Smart growth and development at 4.83%. And then preserving agriculture is really less than a 1% is how we budgeted this year.
Is that preserving agriculture piece, is that including, I'm sure, the extension office?
That's the cooperative extension, the soils department, and forestry.
I'm so glad that you did this slide. I was speaking to somebody, a community leader, within the past few months who has a lot of experience in private industry with implementing strategic plans, and he was expressing his frustration with the county's budget or his opinion that when you have a strategic plan, that should be the driving force behind your budget and that your budget should reflect your plan and its priorities. And so I was very interested to see this and see how much that's true for Alamance County. Can you really see our five pillars reflected in that? It's a big difference for a county government versus a corporation in balancing five things, you know, I think that education is always going to be, and you know, public health and safety would be the monster chunks of the county budget. But to see it reflected like that, I think it's really interesting.
So allocating resources is an ongoing process.
Go back to the last slide really quick.
I don't mind. Okay. But the bigger picture is implementation. When you're going through, and let me look here, implementing our strategic initiatives is not just something new. So much of strategic planning should also include efficiencies, current operations. We have stakeholders, we have our commissioners' guidance and governance, we have our department heads and their expertise, and we have federal and state mandates. All of those things are built into this, so when we're talking about implementing, tactical planning is the new stuff. These are the things where we are looking at something in our community that needs immediate attention, things like our Stepping Up initiative, tackling the opioid problem. These are things that are part of strategic planning, but they are just in addition to our regular operations. And then I skipped ahead a little bit, but data-driven evaluation is what we're headed towards. What we hope to see in the years that we've had our performance management program, we've been gathering metrics, not necessarily knowing that they're the right metrics, but these are the things that we needed to know in order to see, are we being efficient? Are we being effective? And hopefully we're getting to the outcomes that we would like to see achieved. By looking at the data, looking at what outcomes we've actually seen over the course of our performance management programs, and through basically a lot of the budget snapshots and the discussions that department heads have about budget, these are all strategic discussions evaluating their own programs. We do it internally, but you see some of the documentation. The performance management program, a lot of what you'll see there are multi-steps towards a bigger initiative. So even though we don't have a long list of strategic initiatives for your review, it's all built into some of the things that we're already implementing. And we end where we started with communication. Because in the end, we needed a document to explain our overview framework, and we do have ongoing plans for better reporting. Each year, we're adding a layer of reporting about strategic planning. Any questions?
Well, I'd like to make a comment. First of all, I think this is well done, so thank you. And in my experience with strategic planning for an ongoing organization like county government, you know, an organization is so complex and there are so many functions that are done, especially this organization, a real diverse set of functions. And a strategic plan kind of boils down, what is it that we need to concentrate on over the next coming years without compromising what we're doing in all those thousands and thousands of other functions that we do as an organization. So you have to have focus. So I mean, if we have 20 pillars, there would be no focus and we probably wouldn't see any change. And I think maybe that's what happened out of that, the old plan, the destination
2020,
yeah. That was done in 2003. Mm-hmm. So 15 years later, we now have a new plan. But so I think, you know, we have a reasonable number of pillars to work on that will move us forward over the next 5 years, and then we can reassess and maybe come up with different pillars 5 years from now.
You did a great job. Thank you. Yeah. That was
very
really
good job.
That was actually amazing. Hey, Mr.
Haygood,
you had to follow that up.
Well, I will be brief, and let me say I appreciate the work that Libby did on this plan. She did a lot of work, had a lot of help from the library staff hosting these meetings out in the community, and I appreciate Andrea and Michelle and the hard work they've put into doing this. So next meeting, August 6th, we'll have a updated version. And in the meantime, if you have questions or you take it, you look at it, you think of something else you want us to incorporate in the plan, let me know, and we will be sure to do that. That's also for the public, too, that are listening. If they see this plan, they have questions or comments or something they're interested in, they can contact us, and we'll take all that input into account and plan to have you the final product on August 6th for your adoption. So, at this time, I've put in your packet a comprehensive list of all the Alamance County governmental departments' performance management goals for fiscal year 18-19. Many of these goals have been formulated in light of this new strategic plan. It hasn't been adopted yet, but everyone's been kind of working along the lines that these pillars and some of these initiatives would be adopted. The goals that you have in front of you, they're from every single county department. They've all been reviewed by county management. According to our performance management policy, all goals must be presented to the Board of Commissioners. It's not necessary for you to actually vote to approve them or adopt them, but what I'm hoping for tonight is if you've had a chance to review them and you have any questions or comments about specific ones, we'll talk about them. If not, if they look acceptable for you to you at this point, we'll adopt them. They will become our goals, and we will work on them for the upcoming year. So I'm not going to run through them all, but if you have had an opportunity to look at anything has popped out to you, I certainly appreciate all the hard work the departments have put into coming up with these goals. I think that they've done a good job, and they've tried to come up with goals that are appropriate and relevant to the folks that they serve. So this time, if you have any questions or concerns about them, I'll be happy to try to answer your questions.
Well, just with the Board of Elections starting out right there, what Brenda said tonight, they're overworked and they're mandated to do certain things, and I don't even know how you evaluate that. It's
well, Brenda's absolutely right. Kathy does a wonderful job. She comes up with very timely and relevant goals that are in the best interest of the voting public. There's no question about it. We are very fortunate to have her and all her folks. But her goals she sets, a lot of them are state requirements, and that's mm-hmm. great because we have to hit those. We want
right.
Kathy and her folks monitoring, are they staying in compliance with state government? And they always do, and they do a good job. So.
Yeah, legislators tend to push things our way.
Yes.
All right. Well,
I didn't have any comments.
No.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you.
Do you have a report for us tonight?
I do not.
Okay. See my guy in comments? If not.
We're a quiet bunch tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're all worn out. Then there being no further business before the board will be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.